say.
We had a couple of trees in the churchyard in my other parish which needed to come out. It seemed stupid to pay a timber merchant to come and remove them, so we steamed the traction engine, brought her down, and you've seen what happened. Now we're going home. The engine we're on at the moment was built by Fosters of Lincoln in 1927. It was one of their stock 7-horsepower models built for agricultural use. She was kept in agricultural work until 1946, when she was acquired for preservation. Various owners had her, and I got her in 1964. When I first came here, the reaction of the villagers was one of stark disbelief to find their parson driving a steamroller. We used to do a regular run up to the little local market town for shopping and other things, but some of them complained that the foundations of their houses were cracking and the slates were coming off. So we discontinue that one. We just go for a run down the country lanes when we go out now. By the rectory at Cadeby, we've got a collection of road and rail vehicles of various periods, most steam propelled. The father of them all is a 1903 Abingham Porter steam roller. It was the local one used in this district. And when it was withdrawn from service in 1961, I managed to acquire it. There's also a 1912 steam roller belonging to a friend of mine who lives in Derby. That's kept at the rectory. And there's a rather late steam roller of 1926, belonging to a young boy from Sutton Coalfield. And my crew member here's roller, which is a Roby tandem compound, rather a rare machine. That also was built in Lincoln. Get all the joy of heaven and all the joy of sharing the fun of it with the other people who come to us.
If you're wondering how the Reverend manages to afford a large collection of steam vehicles on a vicar's stipend, the answer is he can't. Most of the large exhibits in the Cadeby collection are not his. They're owned and maintained by his friends who use the vicar's backyard as a base. In fact, some of the bits and pieces have been lying around here for quite some time now.
Strange enough, we are actually registered as one of the National Transport Museums. Well, we're always open to the public on the second Saturday of each month. It would be unwise to say the collection is complete. It will never be complete. It's always growing, but the main problem now is one of consolidation and display rather than acquisition. We started it in 1961, soon after I moved down here, and it, like everything else, it grows gradually.
Wish you can put in another boss on that side of the wheel.
Hello, Jeff.
Brings the axle.
Although most people think that a country parson's got nothing to do all day, in actual fact, in a country parish, you have an extraordinary amount to do, whether it's visiting people in hospital, or mending their lawnmowers, or just going round looking after them generally. It doesn't give you a lot of time to get away, certainly at weekends. That's quite impossible. And so the only thing to do was to build a railway ourselves. We think we're the shortest 2-foot gauge line in the country. We're only about 100 yards long on the main line. We've got a few more 100 yards in sidings. But we have 4 steam locomotives and about 6 diesels. It's a sort of, not exactly a graveyard, but it's a resting place for narrow gauge engines which are gradually being restored. At the moment, we've got one which is nearing completion. That's Pixie. She's really the star of this film, but unfortunately she isn't with us. Then we've got an Onstein and Koppel which is being restored. That has some work to be done on it before it'll be given the boiler certificate. We have 2 engines from the Penryn quarries, Margaret, which is being restored very slowly, but is being restored, and Sergeant Murphy, the one down in the dell at the end of the line, which is waiting restoration. We are, I suppose, carrying on the spirit of the old Colonel Stevens railways. Colonel Stevens was a delightful gentleman who undertook the running of semi-derelict and run down branch lines and bought up old locomotives so long as they got a little bit of life in them, and then let them out to grass when they completely worn out. Even though the glorious temporarily departed in the absence of steam, we still managed to keep going on diesel. Right, Jeff. I was driving was quite an interesting machine. It started life in the First World War. It was one of the last engines left in the country to work on the light railways in the trenches of the First World War. And it came back and ran for many years on the rather prosaic duties of the Birmingham sewage works at Minworth. If it's raining, of course, we're not limited to the exhibits outside. We come in here. The layout represents part of the old Great Western Line in South Devon, as it was about 1935. It's a personal choice, really, because I was born and bred on the Great Western at Solihull. But the Great Western was described, probably by Brunel, rather aptly as a line built by gentlemen for gentlemen. You always associate it with the rolling western countryside and cathedrals, rather than with the busy industrial Midlands. We work it with the locomotives which are necessary for the job. There are 18 trains in regular service, and each train has its spare engine on shed, which gives us, I suppose, somewhere around about 35, allowing for shunters. Running stock? Honestly, I don't know. There must be about 100, 120 coaches out here, and probably about 200 goods vehicles. Though the goods vehicles actually aren't so prominent as the passenger stock, because it is essentially a model of passenger worked area. We've tried to model not only the locomotives, but the sort of trains that they hauled, and the scenery, and the buildings. This is the high ground, the edge of Dartmoor. You can see the moor in the background, and the place actually is Naneby, connected by a branch line, of which this is the terminus, to the main line at Alton Prior. We have visiting clubs and societies down. For example, we had Oxford University Railway Society down last week. They were in here for 4 hours. They managed to get the first 100 trains of the 180 train days program through. And then they finally gave up and we had to drag them into the house to have some tea. They were about frozen. But we get quite a lot of visitors. But although it's not a particularly large railway, it is probably one of the largest which is designed to work not just with trains running around chasing their tails, but as the actual line was worked on which it's modelled. It isn't so much a question of playing trains here. We operate an actual timetable taken from the Great Western's operating timetable of 1938. It takes 8 people to do it. We work it as far as we possibly can to the actual signalling regulations that the Great Western were running under in 1938. The signalling apparatus is simple enough. It's taken from the original Great Western instruments. In fact, most of them are original Great instruments. These two are the spanulated double line absolute block instruments. These are the bells relating to them. If we were going to have a trip, we were offering a stopping train forward, we should call the signalman's attention with one beat on the bell. That would be answered by a single beat. Then we should describe the train, in this case a stopping passenger, 3 beats with a pause and one beat. And then he would give us the line clear on his instrument. I shall have to do it here. And use the up line instead of the down line, like that. Then when the train had actually left our station, we would give him train on line, which is 2 beats. This is not repeated on the Great Western, but was on every other one. He acknowledges it by putting his instrument to train on line. And that locks all our signals. We can't do anything until the train has passed him. And he then gives us train out of section, which would come down as a 2 and a 1. We shouldn't offer it back, but I'll indicate it on this instrument. And would also drop his instrument, and that clears all our signals so we can get ready for signalling the next train. The moment we've got an interesting problem in that the LMS have offered us the Dan Aberdeen sleepers approximately 2 hours behind time. I've got a goods train which I want to send forward. I can't send it forward as an ordinary freight, but I shall have to send it forward as a 341, which means a train to be passed through section at the greatest possible speed. So I shall ring the signalman at Rigwell and find out whether he can accept it. Rigwell? Jeff?
Hello, Ted.
Aberdeen's 2 hours down, and I've got a stopping freight through for you. Can you take it as a 341?
Okay, Ted.
Well, I'll put it online to you as that. People tend to accuse us of playing with trains. This is about as sensible as accusing a chess champion of playing with little bits of ivory. A timetable here has been worked out which makes the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius Loyola look like a nice quiet summer holiday. Things are a little more complicated here because we don't work to ordinary time. Obviously, we can't spend 24 hours in here working through a 24-hour schedule. And so we have a clock which has been doctored to run 8 times as fast as any normal clock. And we work to this. This gives us a schedule of 180 train movements in the 24 hours within a compass of 3 hours.